Hello all, this is a short lecture about the basics of electrocardiograms. I am not going to discuss cardiac rhythm interpretation. That is going to be a live lecture during class time. To start, let's make sure we all understand what an EKG is. EKG stands for electrocardiogram. An ECG is the same thing. Some people just spell the word with a K in the middle, and some use a C. It is a non-invasive test, meaning it does not require poking through a patient's skin, mouth, nose, etc. Its function is to measure the electrical activity of the heart and turn it into a format that we healthcare providers can read. We care about measuring the electrical activity of the heart because it will help us determine if there is a problem with the heart's function. When the heart is signaling properly, the sinoatrial node, or SA node, is in charge, the heart's normal pacemaker. It is where the electrical signal to beat should start. However, all heart cells have automaticity, contractility, conductivity, and excitability, meaning any of them can take over the role of pacemaker or receive impulses from a different pacemaker. If the heart's electrical signaling is abnormal, the heart's ability to pump blood is often affected. The EKG tracing helps us figure out what and where the problem is so that we can treat it. EKGs work by collecting information from the electrodes placed on the patient's skin and transmitting them to a machine that can amplify and record these signals either on a monitor or onto graph paper. A picture of what these electrodes can look like is on the bottom right corner of the slide. Sometimes healthcare providers will call the foam electrodes leads, but technically, the lead is the view between two electrodes. Each lead only looks at the electrical activity in front of it. So you can kind of imagine as though each lead is a single camera looking at the heart. We use multiple leads to get a picture from multiple angles. The direction the wave in an EKG tracing points in, also called its deflection, will depend on how the direction of electrical current flow compares to the lead position, or camera position, to use our earlier metaphor. If electricity is flowing toward the positive end of the lead, the wave will be upright. If electricity is flowing to the negative end of the lead, the wave will be downward. And if electricity is flowing perpendicularly, the wave will be biphasic, or have two points. This is not something you need to memorize, it's just here to help you understand why we need more than one lead. This slide is also trying to show you the different views given by each lead. We typically read a rhythm strip in lead 2 because the electrical flow in your heart goes from top to bottom toward the positive end of lead 2, meaning lead 2 will give us the clearest picture with most waves upright. Moving on now to different types of EKG tracing. EKGs vary in the number of leads used to collect data, whether these leads are continuously collecting data over a long period of time, or only collecting it for a very short snapshot of time, and finally, whether the data is being collected in the home or hospital setting. As I just described, one of the ways we can distinguish EKGs is based on the timing of the recording. A healthcare provider may prefer to use continuous EKG monitoring, where there's the potential for ongoing changes in rate, rhythm, conduction, or to evaluate therapy. They may want to also use or alternatively use a 12 or 15 lead EKG when they need to see more than one lead, confirm a diagnosis, or are concerned about ischemia or infarct. A 5 lead EKG is commonly used for continuous monitoring at the bedside. Anatomical landmarks for electrode placement are written on this slide, but there are a few tricks that healthcare providers can use to remember where each electrode goes. There are standard colors for each electrode wire. White rhymes with right, so the white electrode goes on the right shoulder. We can imagine it as a cloud in the sky. The black electrode, we imagine, is a puff of smoke that goes over the red electrode, the fire. The green electrode goes under the white cloud and represents a green field. And finally, the brown electrode is a cow standing in that field. You may have also noticed that this placement looks a lot like the number 5 on a dice, which is another trick to help you with placement. Another type of continuous cardiac monitoring is telemetry. It is similar to bedside monitoring, but instead of being hooked up to a physical monitor in the room, the patient is a small battery-powered device that transmits their electrical rhythm to a monitor elsewhere. A nurse may be responsible for monitoring their own patient's telemetry, or one nurse in the ICU or CCU may be responsible for monitoring the telemetry of multiple patients. A Holter monitor is another kind of continuous EKG monitoring. Much like a telemetry monitor, it is continuously recording someone's heart rhythm. But the difference here is that rather than having to stay in a certain part of the hospital so that their monitor can transmit to a screen a nurse is watching, the Holter monitor is either recording and transmitting the person's heart rhythm or recording and storing it so that it can be read later. Patients are often asked to keep a journal of symptoms they have so that the technician or cardiologist can then go back and correlate any specific symptoms a person is having to actual arrhythmic changes. We're now going to switch away from continuous EKG monitoring and talk about EKGs that just look at one moment in time. The example here we're going to look at is a 12-lead EKG, which in some hospitals a nurse may be responsible for collecting. The placement for the 12-lead is very similar to the 5-lead, except that the leads that are labeled arm and leg actually go on the arms and legs. There are an addition of 5 more V, or precordial leads, that look at the heart, and these go around the precordial area, as you can see in this picture. These are some pictures of equipment commonly used to record a 12 or 15-lead EKG. On the left side, you can see a picture of an EKG machine. There are many different brands of EKG machines, but they pretty much all look like this. On the right side is a picture of the electrodes that can be used with the EKG machine. The square part of the electrode is sticky, and the tab at the end is where the wires from the EKG machine connect to it. Some EKG machines can also connect to the foam electrodes that you saw on an earlier slide for 5-lead EKG monitoring. The last thing I'm going to talk about in this lecture is the EKG paper. This is the physical paper that is either printing out of the bedside cardiac monitor or the EKG machine. It has a standard grid with standard size boxes. There are little boxes and big boxes. Each big box contains 5 little boxes horizontally and 5 little boxes vertically. Time is measured horizontally in seconds. Each little box represents 0.04 seconds, meaning each big box represents 0.20 seconds. Typically, we interpret EKG rhythms using a 6-second strip. A 6-second strip is 30 big boxes long. Hopefully that makes sense, because if you divide 6 seconds by 30, you get 0.2 seconds, the width of each big box. Voltage is measured vertically, and when we're reporting it, we would describe it as millivolts or millimeters. One little box is 1 millimeter tall. That brings us to the end. References are listed on this slide. The actual information is mostly from Medical Surgical Nursing in Canada, with the rest of the references being at the images. If you have any questions or notice any errors in this slide, please feel free to drop me an email. I hope you have a good day.